get back to the discussion. In this session, we are coming back to discuss the policy impact of different perceptions. We have two speakers. The first, Alan Frost. She is now the visiting scholar of Peterson Institute, right? And she was working for the U.S. government for a long time. So, I'm private sector. So I'd like to invite you to speak first. And then second speaker is Professor Tao Wen Zhao, who is now, I think, the number one historian in studying of U.S.-China relations. And he was a deputy director of American Institute at the Chinese Academy of Social Sciences and joined our center last year. So we are really feel honored he can come here. So Alan, please, you're the first.
Thank you very much. Receiving an invitation letter from Stapleton Roy is itself an honor. And as someone who has been interested in Chinese history all my life, anything with Tsinghua's name in it also has special meaning. So thank you both for this invitation. The topic of my paper is how U.S. perceptions of China influence U.S. policy. And I must say, watching American politics in the last 2 years, and someone who started work in the Senate many, many years ago, I've been tempted to write to Queen Elizabeth and say, please take us back. We can't govern ourselves. But, well, my paper addresses and tries to answer two very basic questions. Why are certain perceptions of China magnified and others suppressed or downplayed? And second, to what extent do these perceptions shape U.S. policy? And for reasons of time, I'm going to concentrate mainly on the second question. But I do begin by surveying sources of perceptions influencing U.S. policy, and in particular, four groups. We've talked some about the media, but in addition, I want to say something about the business community, outside experts, and then non-government organizations and civil society. I also wrote about filters through which policymakers and the American public more generally select, process, and channel perceptions of China. They're very characteristic American filters, and as America watchers, my Chinese colleagues will probably be familiar with most of them anyway. All right, well, the first question is then, why are certain perceptions magnified or distorted or downplayed? And my thesis here is that the way that perceptions are selected and processed depends on the extent to which they resonate with or contradict characteristic American values, attitudes, self-images, and our view of our role in the world. These are what I call the emotional drivers of the filtering process. Here I won't talk much now about values and attitudes because I think most of you are familiar with sort of the basics, but I do want to add something about our discussion of individualism, which I think was so important this morning. I wrote about this in my paper, but I also cut a lot out to save time. I think that what I want to add is that Americans see individualism as a source of strength for the whole society, for the group. The characters used in Chinese for individualism suggest selfishness or self-centeredness. And that's not at all the American idea. Individualism and the opportunity to fulfill oneself as an individual can lead you to a career of public service, can lead you to dedicate yourself to the group or the community or the neighborhood or the nation. And as such, it's not a source of disharmony at all. It's an opportunity for a stronger society. But in our emphasis on individualism, I think, obscures our characteristic adherence or volunteering to groups. This is something de Tocqueville noticed in the 19th century. And there's been a book recently by the sociologist Robert Bella and several colleagues called The Habits of the Heart. And he finds the same thing, that if you ask Americans what is a good life, it's an opportunity to do my own thing without hurting anybody else. But in practice, Americans are enormous joiners. We have civil society, we have church groups, we have all sorts of volunteer organizations. I myself am on the board of a non-government organization. Lots and lots of group activities. So I think that picking up something Jamie Horsley said, I think this contrast should not be exaggerated, and it should be put in that that context. We are a bit suspicious of this harmonious society business. It there's a big difference, as Tian Wei observed, I think, that between harmony that is sort of papers over legitimate differences in opinion and legitimate differences in interest on the one hand, and on the other hand, the stability that results when people have had a chance to air their concerns and some sort of compromise has worked out. Thank you. So I do think that this is our understanding of the world is that other people want to be sort of like us, and but when they perceive the negative or selfish aspects of individualism, and when they associate it with selfishness, naturally, they emphasize the contradiction. Another one of these values that or filters is that we tend to think that what's good for the United States is good for the world. This is not generally shared, but we look at the post-war. Look at the post-war role of the United States and our role in setting up global institutions, and we look at prosperity and relative stability since the end of World War II, and we think there's some evidence for this, and we think of ourselves as a benign power, and that's just a filter. Another source of filters is domestic politics, and here China can become a political football in ways that really have very little to do with China's reality. In certain times, and this happened when I was working in different parts of the government, the political opponents of whoever was in the White House would accuse the president of being soft on China. This became a sort of a club with which to hit the opposition. You see this in campaign rhetoric in the past, where Clinton, as a candidate, talked about the butchers of Beijing, right? And he said that Bush had coddled Chinese dictators and so forth. But once in office, presidents tend to settle down and drop all of that rhetoric. And the same thing happens, actually, in the Congress, although there's a lot more heat and rhetoric in the Congress. My years in the Senate taught me to watch what Congress actually does, not what they say. What they do is really what counts in the end. So those are just sort of some of the filters through which all Americans, including policymakers, I think, select and process and channel perceptions of China. My second question in the paper is, to what extent do they actually influence U.S. policymaking? I think that the media coverage, which is quite negative often or one-sided, and even public opinion, which centers on job losses and to a lesser extent on human rights, I think those don't influence policy as much as Chinese think they do. They are there. They are part of what goes into the policymaking process. But, you know, the media role is I think more limited than we sometimes assume. According to the Pew survey, in 2009, only 0.7% of all articles in the U.S. media were related to China, 1.2% of newspaper articles, 1% of online articles, and 0.2% of cable TV segments. Michael Jackson received 10 times as much coverage as China, which says something about news as entertainment. But overall, except for really dramatic events like Tiananmen, neither the U.S. media nor the public pays that much attention to China. Even the conservative groups now making noise, such as the Tea Party, really haven't focused much on China, and it isn't a factor now in our current campaigns, as far as I can tell. So I think the coverage is certainly one-sided and often negative, but I think we shouldn't exaggerate its influence on U.S. policy when it comes right down to it. I think more important are three groups, particularly the business community. It's a major source of perceptions on China, and it is fed directly into the policy-making process. Generally speaking, the big companies have been big champions of closer U.S.-China economic ties, arguing not only that this is good for America's economic interests, but also that a strong business participation in China promotes broader values such as openness and transparency and even the rule of law. There are smaller companies and companies in so-called sensitive sectors like autos and textiles and so on, which tend to pit themselves against these bigger companies, and they're often backed by labor unions. So a good deal of struggle goes on. The Office of the U.S. Trade Representative, which was created by the Congress some years ago, has the lead, and they produce reports on China's business practices. There is it's very interesting reading. The very long list of what China has done to improve opportunities for U.S. companies in the fields of trade, investment, reducing distorting subsidies that hurt foreign companies, and so forth. But the information is all laid out, including the negative information. We've talked about the rule of law here. One of the things that the 2010 report says that China's judicial system is unreliable at best, and where courts or arbitration panels have ruled in favor of foreign firms, enforcement has been very difficult. Local courts, they say, are often subject to political influence and so forth. And companies often choose not to go through the rule of law. They often rely on other kinds of channels in Guangxi and so forth. It was mentioned yesterday, I think, that a survey of U.S. companies in Shanghai reported that business was growing. But of course it's growing because Chinese exports fell into the tank for a short period during the financial crisis. So naturally, companies are growing again and doing relatively well. They don't wish to antagonize Chinese officials any more than Chinese companies do. But they have been reporting to USTR and in the public that there's been somewhat of a worsening of the business climate in China, preference for so-called indigenous innovation, local barriers, local officials putting up roadblocks and so forth that run counter to a stated policy of the central government. And I throw that out as a sort of red flag because the business community is one of the strongest champions of closer U.S.-China engagement. The business community seems to have a kind of mixed view on the hot issue here, which is China's currency. Depends in part on what role they play in China-centered production networks. As you know, what's labeled made in China is actually often China-centered production networks with all kinds of components and materials from the rest of Asia. And so where they fit in that depends in part on whether they import and export both and so forth. So while that issue of the renminbi revaluation is a very hot issue and putting a lot of pressure on Secretary of the Treasury in particular, it is not something which is coming primarily from the business community. I won't say a lot more about the other forces that influence U.S. policy, except very briefly. Our policymaking process does rely a lot on outside experts. One category is military experts. And I have to say, as someone who benefits occasionally from this largesse, that the Defense Department has a whole lot more resources to fund conferences and speaking engagements and strategic reviews and gaming exercises and all kinds of things. Many, many more of these things go on in the defense community than in other parts of the policymaking community. They are typically worried these days about not so much necessarily about force projection per se, or the Indian Ocean, although that's gotten some attention, but what seems to be a strategy of so-called access denial and a growing capacity for space and cyber warfare. That's getting a lot of attention. So, and the lack of transparency in defense spending is also a concern. It's gotten better. China's white papers volunteer more, but there's still a feeling that a lot is hidden, such as foreign arms purchases. So the process of writing the reports that put out by the Defense Department is one of the ways in which policy gets made. People circulate drafts and they hammer on something, and if it's really fundamental, then they escalate it. But these conclusions drawn from this vast array of consulting are published. The main conclusions appear in the Quadrennial Defense Review and the annual report to Congress on China's military spending. It's fairly public. I don't have classified information at my fingertips, but it is a fairly transparent process. I think that the only other thing I'd say about military experts and the policy that results from them is that there's a keen awareness of the hawks in China. There's a good source of people who read Chinese military journals and translate them and make them known. And I think there's general sensitivity in the policy-making process not to do anything that would strengthen the hands of these people who are xenophobic or hostile to America. Economic experts are consulted, I think, to a much lesser degree. They tend to be fairly positive about China. They see a sort of steady path of improvement. There are some different perceptions among them as to whether the rapid recovery from the financial crisis is going to rest on bad loans or any asset bubbles or anything like that. But for the most part, I think the economic experts are pretty positive, and that tends to feed into the policymaking process. The other group I selected, sort of non-government organizations, civil society, I won't say a lot about that. There's a big contrast with China in the process. Some of them have a statutory role. Many of the major ones have significant access. And our personnel system, which ought to be mentioned here, permits these people to come into government, hold government jobs, leave, and sometimes go back in. And when you look at the bios of some of the policymakers, you'll find that they, in fact, come from non-government organizations. Well, I mentioned that the way that perceptions are channeled depends on to what extent they resonate or contradict certain values and attitudes, and I won't talk any more about that for reasons of time, but you'll find it in my paper. My final set of comments is that when this mixture of media coverage, public opinion, and input from the business community, experts, and outside non-government groups come together, policymakers draw on that, but they add two additional overarching, very broad narratives. And it's those narratives that I think are ultimately more important in shaping policy at the end of the day. Those narratives are two, at least two. The first that I identify is that China as a dynamic economic power and constructive political partner. And the second is China as a rising military power and potential political military threat. And here I really want to stress that both of these narratives are inseparable from perceived global and regional imperatives facing the United States as policymakers see them. I mean, because we're talking U.S.-China relations, I think we tend to put blinders on and say that this is just a bilateral relationship. Not at all. Many of the most important people are not specialized in China. They fit China into these two broader narratives. Now, these narratives are worked on through separate vertical bureaucratic chains nicknamed stovepipes. And I've railed for years, as someone who worked in both the Treasury and the Pentagon, I've railed for years about stovepipes and the inability to connect except at the very top of the government. But the fact is that we do decide things on the basis of stovepipes. Both of these groups of policymakers in the respective stovepipes, they really do believe that a stable China is much better for the U.S. than an unstable China. They are positive about engagement. I mean, there are a few crazy people in every group, but most of the time I think they They are positive about China, and China's extreme suspicion about containment and wanting to weaken China really, I think, is misplaced. And I can say this based on many personal conversations. But there's a core question that I think is sort of at the center of what happens at the end of the day, it's that there's some concern, I think, about rising nationalism and some recent backsliding on human rights and economic openness, and they're not sure what this signals about China's future evolution. And that evolution question is basic. The people who handle economic affairs tend to think that economic growth promotes openness, transparency, and status quo attitude in foreign policy and so forth. But they certainly don't see conflict or war with China in the picture. The people in the strategic or military stovepipe basically agree that economic development is a good thing in China, but some of them look at the history of rising powers in the international system and believe that negative outcomes are quite possible. So, for example, they think that when China gets strong enough, it could try to retake Taiwan by force and try to drive the United States out of Asia and so forth, at least in subtle ways. So the even China's supporters in Washington can't dismiss exactly these fears about China's future evolution. So I think the most basic question is, do you look at China as a straight line from the bad days of Mao and the Cultural Revolution, and you project that forward 20 years, in which case you end up with maybe authoritarian capitalism and sort of rivalry, which is perfectly manageable, or do you kind of project the view that as China gets richer, it's going to be able to drive the United States out and work against U.S. goals? And since nobody knows the complete answer to that question, it sort of lingers through the policy debates. And the Chinese make a great point of not promoting their own values and trying to tell other governments what to do, as opposed to the quote-unquote hegemon, which is a thinly veiled reference to us. But the flip side of this non-interference policy is that nobody quite knows what kind of world the Chinese government would like to see in the future. We would assume it would be a more open, peaceful, trade-oriented system, and sometimes you get messages like that. But we don't really know what kind of world the Chinese want because they don't, they haven't articulated it. And what makes that worse is the secretive nature of Chinese decision-making. Granted that it's getting more open, there's still a tradition of secrecy that way predates the communist era, probably goes back to the Han Dynasty. And as some of us have argued before in this conference, this habit of secrecy, we think, hurts China's interests because it leads people to assume the worst. So finally, the result of all of this, I say, is the grand compromise. It's a hedging strategy. Engagement, cooperation on solving global problems, all of these good things combined with continued military readiness combined with certain restrictions on high technology trade and technology transfer concern for human rights but blanketed and put behind the scenes, a mixed strategy. And I would end by arguing that this is really different from public opinion, because this hedging strategy, as I call it, or this balanced approach, cautious optimism, if you like, is actually quite consistent, I think. And it does reflect sort of longstanding U.S. Concerns and filters. So whereas public opinion is what Terry Louts calls consistently inconsistent, I think in the end, when the dust settles and you look at what the U.S. actually does, I think U.S. policy through Republican and Democratic administrations is fairly consistent, which I think is a good thing for the stability of U.S.-China relations and our ability to manage these tensions. So I'll end with a quote that I like to use when foreigners are present in the audience. It's a quote attributed to Winston Churchill. He said, allegedly, you can always count on Americans to do the right thing after they've exhausted the alternatives. I'll end there. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Professor Tao, please.
Thank you, thank you, Ambassador Roy, for inviting me to attend this very timely and important conference. And also thank you, Dr. Sun, for including me into the Chinese team. And I'm proud of being a part of it. I was a visiting scholar with the Asia program with Dr. Bob Hathaway in summer 2002. I'm very glad to be back. I will divide my presentation into two parts. In the first part, I'm going to make a very brief review of our bilateral relations to see how China's perception of the United States evolved in the past 31 years, and how those perceptions changed China's policy. And in the second part, I'm going to discuss about mainstream thinking now in China of the United States and the policy implications. Past 31 years, I think, can be divided into three periods, roughly 10 years for one period. From 1979 to early 1989, the United States was viewed in China as a strategic ally in opposing and resisting the Soviet expansion, as well as economic partner in China's modernization. Actually, Ambassador was a witness to that. You know, the normalization negotiations took place at the same time with the third plenum of 11th Party's Congress. And that was not a coincidence. Actually, in Deng Xiaoping's grand strategy of reform and openness, to normalize relations with the United States was a very important component part. I can list a lot of arguments from Deng Xiaoping's selected writings and his other works. Well, when Deng Xiaoping visited the United States at the end of January 1979, he even talked to President Carter about the possibility of giving Vietnam a lesson. So he certainly viewed the United States as a strategic ally. And during those 10 years, I would call it a golden age in Sino-American relations, not honeymoon, because honeymoon cannot last for 10 years. It's a golden age. Our bilateral relations reached tremendous development in every aspect, in political, economic, strategic, especially mirror-to-mirror relationship. The United States relaxed control of the high-tech export to China and even asked the European countries to sell some weapons to China. Yeah. And U.S. Military visited a lot of Chinese facilities, and we visited a lot of American military facilities. Well, given the present mirror-to-mirror relationship between our two countries, I really miss that period. And I even think that mirror-to-mirror relationship between our two countries probably can never return to that degree in the foreseeable future. So this is a period, I think the first period. The second period, after Tiananmen Square incident in June 1989 until the end of the last century, I think this is a period of a renormalization of our bilateral relations after the end of the Cold War. During the first Clinton years, the United States put a lot of pressure on China, tried to impose China, tried to press China to change its policy or even change its regime. Some U.S. scholars recognized that was first Clinton years policy a priority. And I think, again, Ambassador Roy was a witness. I have a great admiration for Ambassador, but I really feel sorry for him because he was ambassador in Beijing at a wrong time.
Take him back.
our relations, you know, during the first Clinton years until early to from 1993 to early 1996 were really very, very tense, and given the so-called linkage between China's MFN with human rights, etc., lots of such kind of things. So at that time, what Chinese leaders and the Chinese people were talking about the United States is a peaceful evolution. Yeah, that was a major topic. Chinese leaders were talking about that. Yeah, we said the Clinton administration, what the Clinton administration did was just the same as Secretary Dulles advocated in 1950s, peaceful evolution. But after a few years, I think the Clinton administration recognized that wouldn't work. So starting from May 1996, Clinton shifted his emphasis of a policy from evolution, peaceful evolution, to stability of Sino-American relations. And actually, I would give a great credit to the president. Later on, he made a lot of efforts in doing so. And then the Chinese leaders stopped talking about peaceful evolution. Yeah, that's very clear, and Jiang Zemin has such kind of a speech. I think the symbol of a renormalization of our bilateral relations was President Jiang Zemin's visit to the U.S. in October 1997 and President Clinton's return visit in June 1998. And also, the President Clinton and his high-level officials made great efforts to, for instance, criticize Li Denghui's two-state theory, Liang Guolun, and made great efforts in pushing PNTR legislature in the Congress. I think during the Clinton years, there are two most important legislatures in foreign affairs. One is NAFTA. The other is China's PNTR. Yeah. So at that time, China viewed Clinton administration, viewed the United States quite positively. Even during the most dark days of the tragic embassy bombing, Chinese leaders made great efforts to calm down students' emotions. The bombing happened in the morning, Saturday morning. May 8th, Saturday morning, Beijing time. And the next day, at 6 o'clock in the evening, Vice President Hu Jintao delivered a television speech. On the one hand, of course, he praised students' patriotism. But on the other hand, and his emphasis was on that, we should keep order in our society. We should protect foreigners in China, foreign businessmen. We should do all according to the international laws and the practice, in generally accepted practice in international relations. And 1 week later, President Jiang Zemin himself delivered a speech in a welcoming meeting of the Chinese diplomats from Yugoslavia. On the one hand, he said we should criticize, oppose hegemony. But on the other hand, we should develop normal relations with the United States. And actually, his emphasis was on that hand. Yeah. So this incident, this tragedy, did not influence China's entry into WTO. And actually, it, to a certain degree, accelerated the negotiations between China and the United States. And we know that these two countries reached their agreement in November. So the third period is this century's 10 years. Yesterday, Dr. Zhang Zhengjie mentioned that President Bush is still very popular among Chinese. And Tory asked the question, why? I would address that question. I think mainly because of three reasons. First one, President Bush is a free trader. Even in 2000, when the Congress was debating China's PNTR, and President Bush was campaigning, he released an open letter to senators and congressmen of both parties, asking them to support China's PNTR, to let China become a U.S. normal trade partner. And then the Clinton, the Bush administration supported China's accession to WTO. This is the first question, first reason. Second reason, President Bush was supportive of Beijing Olympic Games in 2008. When China was making bid in 2001, the Bush administration took a neutral position towards China's bid. While in comparison, in 1993, when Beijing was making bid, the U.S. Congress passed a resolution opposing Beijing's bid. And then in April 2006, when President Hu Jintao came to visit the United States, he invited President Bush to pay visit to China. President Bush said he will be in Beijing in August 2008 to attend Olympic Games opening ceremony. So President Bush was the first foreign leader to openly declare he would be at the opening ceremony. And since then, he did not change his position, even after, riot in Tibet in March 2008, we know that some European leaders changed their position. They first, tend to attend the ceremony, but later on they rejected. So when we were discussing about that question, Neibu, we said a lot of leaders of developing countries certainly would attend the ceremony. And then if President Bush and the Japanese Prime Minister would be there, that's fine. That would be a success of our opening ceremony. So, in spite of mounting pressures from Congress and from candidates of both parties, both Republican and Democratic Party, President Bush did not change his position. He said, I would go to China to pay respect to the Chinese people. And he was there for 2 days watching the watching the basketball between China and the United States, and watching a lot of other games.
4 days.
4 days, okay. So, actually, that left with a very good impression with the Chinese people, especially with the young people. And third one, his policy toward Taiwan. In the first years, in 2001 and 2002, he made some wrong remarks, seems to me wrong remarks or wrong sayings about Taiwan, saying that he would take whatever it took to defend Taiwan or help Taiwan to defend itself. But in later years, starting from 2003, he adjusted his position. And in his meeting with Wen Jiabao on December 9th, 2003, actually that meeting was televised by CCTV Channel 4, Channel 9, and I was there in studio. He said that his policy would be opposed to the unilateral change of the status quo across the strait. And he said the leader of Taiwan, his comments and remarks show that he may be willing to change the status quo unilaterally, which we oppose. And that remark is very, very important. And after that, until the 2008, President Bush and the Bush administration, the high-level officials, were open, strong, in opposing the jury independence of Taiwan secessionist forces. So 4 days after March election 2008, President Putin, Hu Jintao, talked to President Bush, expressing his appreciation of the U.S. government and President Bush's sticking to one China policy and three joint communique. So I think mainly because of these three reasons, President Bush left with a very good impression with Chinese people, especially with young people, in spite of some wrongdoing or some wrong saying of Bush himself and some high-level officials. I won't mention their names. Well, yesterday, Tori also asked the question, how do Chinese people view Obama's winning of the election? I think I would say 3 points. First one, we think that that shows the progress of the U.S. society achieved in the past decades. 40 or 50 years ago, no one would imagine that American people would vote, black black person, an African American as a president. So this was this is really a progress, and it shows that American democracy is real. You know, some ordinary people think in that way. Yeah. Second one, it shows that American people were really satisfied with President Bush's policy, internally or externally, with one crisis and two wars. Yeah. And thirdly, it shows the attractiveness of Obama's personality. Yeah. And you know that better than I do. Well, that is my first part. Then the second part, I was discussing some mainstream thinking in China of the U.S. and Sino-American relations. By mainstream, I mean Chinese policymakers, Chinese elites, and also majority of the public. First one, the United States is the only superpower and will remain so for decades to come. After the financial crisis broke out in September 2008, there's a lot of discussion or even debate in China whether the United States is declining. Some people published articles and made speeches arguing that there's a dramatic shift in power balance between China and the United States. And now China can say no, China can ask for more, etc. But after many discussions, most people have come to the same conclusion. Even after 15 or 20 years or 30 years, when China's GDP surpasses the US GDP, that's possible. Even at that time, US will still be the only superpower, given the comprehensive national strengths, given economic power, military power, technological innovation, and a lot of other reasons. So this is now a common recognition in China. I can say this is a quite a common recognition, and. Second one, the Obama administration has realized that the unilateral approach does not work. And so the Obama administration earnestly wants to establish a very broad partnership with all the countries possible. And it also wants to have a partnership with China to deal with regional and global issues. Yeah. President Obama said a lot that Sino-American relations would be one of the most important relationship in the 21st century, or even no relationship, no bilateral relationship is more important than Sino-American relationship. And we think that is an honest expression. Yeah, he really wants to establish a global partnership with China. Third one, but there are still many people in the United States, especially in intelligence and defense circles, those people still view China's rise, or even peaceful rise, as a threat to the U.S. supremacy. They still want to slow down China's development, or to check China's development, or to balance China's development. For instance, the United States now deploys 7 aircraft carriers in the Pacific after over 11 aircraft carriers, deploys 60% of submarines in Pacific, and makes a frequent military drill in the vicinities of China. Yeah. The fourth one, yesterday Zhang Zhuanqi also mentioned Taiwan is still the most important and sensitive issue in Sinai migrations. That's true. And the U.S. insists on arms, continuing arms sales to Taiwan after more than 30 years. So many Chinese, including policymakers, elites, and public, think that United States still needs Taiwan as a card in dealing with China. If you look at Mr. Chen Jicheng, the former vice premier's memoir, Wai Jiao Shi Ji, 10 Events in Foreign Affairs, he clearly wrote that the U.S. policy is to use Taiwan card to check China or to curb China's development. Yi Tai Zhi Hua. I know American colleagues would not agree with that, but I should frankly say that is the mainstream thinking in China now. The fifth one, China is U.S. important economic partner, and the economic interdependence between our two countries continues to be deepened. But our economic and trade relations benefit differently to various sections, various industries, and various regions. So some regions, some industry, they may raise questions, may raise disputes with China. And some politicians from the Congress may use those trade disputes for their own purposes. So that is a widely viewed, why in the U.S. Congress there are so many noise about RMB exchange rate and some other issues. Lastly, I would talk about some policy implications. First one, China does not and will not challenge U.S. supremacy in the world. China has no capability and has no intention to do so. I talked to a lot of American scholars, American friends. We have learned two lessons. One lesson we learned from the collapse of the Soviet Union: never challenge the U.S. supremacy. That's why Deng Xiaoping said, never be ahead and never carry the banner. What's the banner? The banner of anti-Americanism. He said we should not carry that banner. The another lesson we learned from Bush administration's unilateralism, that is, to be a superpower is exhausting. So China will not challenge U.S. supremacy. China will not become superpower. Second one, China is a beneficiary and active participant of the present international regime. In the past 31 years, China reached tremendous development within that regime. And in the next 30 years or even longer time, China will continue to reach its to have its development within that regime. So China will not subvert that regime, will not overthrow that regime, will not establish another regime for herself. Yeah. And China will do something to improve this regime. Well, in September 2005, Bob Zelek put forward a very famous notion to be a responsible stakeholder of the present international regime. And I think China is responsible stakeholder of the international regime. And China will continue to do so in the future. Yeah. A third one, Taiwan. This is still a very important question for China. You know, just in the last session, someone asked about China's idea, and Professor Liu gave a very good answer, but I would think rejuvenation of the Chinese nation, 振兴中华民族, that is China's idea. With rejuvenation, we should complete our reunification. So China will certainly reach the reunification in this century. And this is our set goal. So we think that Taiwan is a part of China, no problem. And whether Chinese government or Chinese people would not let Taiwan be independent, that's for sure, no problem. Second one, but we understand it would take some time. You know, given the 60 years of separation, given the different developments in the mainland and Taiwan since 1895, that's 170 years. In Taiwan, people have a different way of life, different ideology, and so-called the consciousness or Taiwan identity. So to bridge the gap between mainland and Taiwan takes time. So the peaceful development policy across Taiwan Strait is not a modus vivendi. It is for considerably long period. But we think that as long as the peaceful development policy works, we are going towards the final reunification. And the final solution probably, and I think most probably, is peaceful, because that solution works for the best interests of mainland and Taiwan, for the whole Chinese nation. Fourth, the United States has been China's important economic partner for the past 31 years, and will remain so in the future. US and China are mutually the second largest trade partners, and China is the third largest US export market and the most rapidly increasing export market. And we have trade differences and trade disputes, but I think all these disputes can be managed. We now have a strategy and economic dialogue. We have a JCCT and other channels, so we can discuss, we can solve all these differences through all these channels. And even we cannot solve by US and China, then we have a WTO's mechanism of disputes solving. So trade disputes would not subvert China's relations. And lastly, China also maintains that the difference between our two countries, such as the differences over human rights, should be addressed in the spirit of equality and mutual respect, without imposing one's view on the other. For this, I would again give appreciation to the Obama administration, to the efforts of the administration has made to Obama's visit to China last November, and the joint statement between our two countries. I think that joint statement has incorporated a lot of very important principles. In conclusion, I would like to say that Sino-American relations has never been a plain sailing. We always have problems, even ups and downs and differences. But in the darkest day of our bilateral relationship, in December 1989, Mr. Deng Xiaoping said to Scott Crawford and James Baker, the special envoys of Bush, that at last our bilateral relations have to be improved. This is the necessity of the world peace. It gave us a lot of courage in dealing with our bilateral relations. And after so many years, we have accumulated a lot of experiences. So I think we are smart enough, I think the both countries, we are smart enough to overcome our differences and to increase our mutual trust and to upgrade our bilateral relations to a new level. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Now we have about 10 minutes Q&A. You please. Hold on. Let's get the mic.
Yafeng Xiao, currently a Wilson Center scholar. My question, I have to first thank you very much, Dr. Frost and Professor Tao, for your excellent presentation. Now, my question is to Professor Tao. Professor Tao categorize or summarize the U.S.-China relation in the last 30 years into three time periods. The first time period is the strategic ally or alliance. My question is that if we say that the United States and China now enter into a marriage in 1979, now the honeymoon to me only lasts 2 or 3 years, because many of you might know by 1981-82, because the U.S. sending of weapons to Taiwan, so then the August 17 communique between U.S. and China. And also by 1984, the Chinese Communist Party 12th Congress reaffirmed China's independent
1982.
Foreign...
1982.
Yes, but I say that the 12th Party Congress is 1984.
82.
Okay, I'm sorry for that. But by 1984, the Chinese was very clearly reasserted its foreign policy, independent foreign policy. So could we still regard China's relation with the United States from 1982 to 1989 as a strategic ally, as Professor Tao said? Thank you very much.
I'll let people ask more questions. Professor Tao, prepare. You and the gentleman in the back.
Bing Ru Wan from the Chinese Media Net. Based on Mr. Tao's presentation, we heard you mentioned the priority policy of Clinton's administration. So my question to Mrs. Foster is, what is the priority policy of Obama's administration? And I definitely think you disagree with Mr. Tao when he mentioned U.S. policy is to use Taiwan to cut the relation of curb China. So I wonder what your interpretation is. Thank you.
Very good. Please give the mic to the gentleman in the back.
Bob Hathaway here at the Wilson Center. My question is for Tao and Zhao. I took note of your statement that many in China still believe that people in the defense and the intelligence establishment here see China as a threat or at least a serious challenge. How was the firing of General McChrystal seen in China? And did that lead to any speculation about this other point that you made about who makes the final decisions here in Washington?
Thank you, Bob. The young guy in the back, Jerry, I'll let you hold. You make the final and best comments, right?
Rennie Kam with the Congressional Executive Commission on China. Thank you very much for your presentations. Professor Tao, you stated that many in China don't see that Obama's unilateral approach is working. But
Bush's
unilateral approach isn't working. Well, Obama is going along that same route, but many, I think, in the U.S. see that he's getting rebuffed by China, such as with the Copenhagen climate talks. His visit in China last year largely was viewed as unsuccessful within the U.S. How were these situations viewed in China, and as well with the Iran sanctions, for example, and what do you see as China's role in the world in the future? Thank you.
Okay. Maybe pick up two more questions, like Tian Wei and Zhou Qing'an and Jerry.
Thank you once again, Professor Sun, for giving the opportunity. Very brief question for two presenters. First of all, to Dr. Frost, you talk about China, many here see China as a rising power, yet the perception back at home in my country is that China is a returning power. And therefore, the way China think about its future and its relations with the rest of the world would be very different from that of a new, so-called new rising power. How would you interpret that? And Professor Tao, I really enjoy you try to give more explanation as to why George W. Bush is more popular than anybody else in the U.S. presidential history for Chinese. But you talk about one reason is that about Taiwan. Bush did say very clearly about remain the status quo across the Taiwan Straits. I remember at that time I was a Washington correspondent here and pressed the State Department for three times in public about exactly what the position was. I didn't get it from Mr. Richard Boucher, which is a very nice gentleman, until the fourth time, and I did get it. So remember those days really well. But I wonder, this is the question here, how sophisticated do you think the Chinese public understanding about other country in relations with China? Are they judging the other country mainly on very materialistic standards? For example, material wealth, such as trade, or giving China face, which is the Olympics, or are they judging them with some kind of value or with some kind of vision as to exactly how those policies would impact on the rest of the world and the future of the rest of the world, and therefore China as well, because China is going to be whatever, a returned or a rising power. So thank you very much.
Yeah.
Thank you. Zhou Qingyan from Tsinghua University. Thank you for your wonderful presentation. So my question is to Dr. Frost. I really appreciate that you mentioned some aspect of American policy making to China, such as business committee and military aspects. So as we know that there is a saying, politics stops at the water. So when we talk about Americans' policy to China, actually we mentioned many Americans' domestic politics difference and different perspective to China, such as the Yellow Sea military affairs happened recently. So we cannot get very clear, to Chinese people, we cannot get very clear policy perceptions from American policymakers. When we get the hearing from the Congress, when we get the speaking from the Central Commander, when we got the information from the Department of State, information mixed and give them very complex, very different perspective. So how far to keep the policy perspective stable, such as these affairs? Thank you.
Thank you very much. Jerry, you have 2 minutes, and then each of the speakers have 5 minutes to respond.
Thank you. I think the presentations were wonderful, and Professor Tao's speech was one of the greatest speeches I've ever heard come from a Chinese scholar or anyone from China. It was, and I've heard many, I've heard many good ones. Both in substance and delivery form. Very impressive. Now, the subject here is how do perceptions influence U.S. policy? That was one subject, at least. And I endorse what Ellen said. I just wanted us to focus specifically on one important group of perceptions from the human rights community in the United States, which I think I'm part of. And before China's entry into the WTO, we felt we had a lot more impact on China's human rights performance, at least in specific instances, largely through Congress, as much as at least through the executive. After China's entry into WTO and when Congress no longer played an important role, we lost that leverage. The CECC and the Security Economic Review Commission have not, although they play useful roles, they have not remotely exercised much influence over China on human rights or almost on anything. Now we have the Obama administration came in, and the question was, what would it do? Before it got staffed up in relevant positions, Secretary Clinton, Hillary Clinton, made an unfortunate statement that made it seem like human rights would take a very secondary position, if that, because we have a lot of important subjects to negotiate with China, which indeed we do. after a year of staffing and some other boo-boos, we now are trying to find a better place where human rights fits into this complex relationship where we all recognize we have many other things at stake. And I always say the right to avoid nuclear extermination is the most basic human right. Normally, we don't think about things like that when we talk about human rights. Americans have a rather narrow version of it, political and civil rights. And that's where most of us do our focusing. Now we have to think, what will the next years be with China? And the reinstitution of the official human rights dialogue is useful. Most American officials, and we have some very good ones now in office concerned with this, they recognize most of these official dialogues in human rights from the foreign point of view are meaningless. It's a kind of the Chinese sort of tolerate our, they babysit us to listen to our complaints, but nothing much comes out of it. Now we're talking about resurrection of the legal experts dialogue of official nature, but including non-experts in order to make the dialogues more substantive. And that's slowly being talked about. We don't see much action. In the meantime, semi-official or unofficial human rights dialogues are beginning to develop, and that may be a little bit more promising. Under the State Information Office of the State Council, you have a semi-official dialogue through the National Committee on U.S.-China Relations. Jamie and I have taken part in that, as others have. We hope to have another session that shows some modest promise. Now I know there'll be others. Tsinghua University itself is going to have a dialogue at the end of the month, Dean Wong has told me. I think we should encourage these people-to-people things to the extent they can really be uncontrolled, independent dialogues. I think it's very useful. So the human rights community finds it's had not much impact yet on Obama policy, but there are people in the administration who are trying to be responsive and give us some outlet, and we hope we'll have serious discussions, not just konghua, empty talk about these things. And Chinese critiques of our human rights situation are also worthy of our consideration. So I'm mildly optimistic that we'll continue to see some input in the human rights area. Obviously, it can't be preeminent unless you define human rights, as maybe we should, to include climate control as well as nuclear controls and other aspects.
Thank you, Jerry. I'll let Dr. Frost speak first.
Thank you. I'm going to take the questions not necessarily in the order they came. First, to Tian Wei on rising versus resurgent. I make a point most of the time of saying resurgent instead of rising in recognition of China's historical role. But there is a difference between China's economic resurgence and China's military power. Throughout the thousands of years of Chinese history, there was, particularly in as recently as 1800, China's economic power was considerable, but its military power was relatively weak and, throughout this period, despite the Zhenghe voyages and so forth. But in that context, there are people who say that a sort of a new tribute system is emerging, kind of modern version of the tribute system. And so other countries are sort of going to adopt a tributary role, and David Kang is known for this view. Amitabh Acharya disputes it, and anyway, it reminds me of that particular debate. The only other comment I'd make is that I think it's time, many of us feel anyway, that I think it's time for China to get over its defensiveness and its victim mentality. China may perceive itself as poor and still weak. This was the case with Japan in the 1980s, by the way. We saw a giant, and they saw themselves as poor. There are many differences, but there's a defensive mentality, a victimhood mentality that still lingers in the Chinese policy pronouncements as we see it, and we Americans tend to think that the time for that is past. Secondly, the comment about getting Obama getting rebuffed by China and the Obama trip and so forth that came from the CECC representative. I think that this was I have two thoughts about this. One is that on the president's trip, this was one example, not of one-sided reporting, but a really inaccurate and wrong reporting. James Fallows, who isn't here today, I guess, took the opportunity to write publicly that the press had delivered us a manufactured failure. That was his words. The trip, I think, was a success. I really fault the press on this. But more broadly, I think it's fair to say that Obama needs a win. He needs a victory. He came in talking multilateralism and respect and listening and so on, which I think continues to be the right approach. But sort of nothing has gone right. I mean, North Korea's gotten worse. Iran's gotten worse. Israel's still as bad as ever, if not worse. So he kind of needs a little help, I think, on the foreign policy front, because the conservatives are beginning to tear him apart for being, you know, weak and indecisive. So I think he needs a win, and I hope that he can get it from China. Third, the question about politics stops at the water and the Yellow Sea and how Chinese people can't get a clear policy perception from Professor Zhou. First of all, the idea that politics stops at the water has not been true for decades, I think. It's still an ideal, and people try to talk the bipartisan talk, but in fact, it's a long time since that's been true. I was working in the Senate when the issue of free immigration from the Soviet Union was hot, and the so-called Jackson-Vanik Amendment was passed. And here, I think there's a difference. And Jerry mentioned that we sort of gave up our leverage on China when China's admission to the WTO legally forced us to abandon that annual review of free immigration. There was supposedly a joke for Joe and Lai saying, you know, how many million people do you want? I don't know if he really said that or not. But there's a big difference here in terms of leverage. The Soviet Union discovered that the Jewish scientists wanting to emigrate to Israel were a source of leverage with the U.S., that we were willing to pay a certain price to get these people released. But the release of those scientists, most of whom had been already relieved of their job, did not threaten the Soviet Union's fundamental interests in any way. It was as if the Soviets said, oh gosh, we've got this something the U.S. wants, but it was not going to bring down the Soviet system or even challenge it fundamentally. Other things did that, but not the immigration of a few scientists or the treatment of Andrei Sakharov, in my view. Whereas with China, I think there is a difference. That is that it's true that there's a certain bargaining chip that China has with Fang Lijie and a few individuals, but mainly I think the improvement of human rights in response to U.S. pressure is perceived as counterproductive to China's basic order, basic stability, and the step-by-step process that Professor Swin and J.B. Horsley have advocated is about as far as they want to go. So I'm not sure we really do have leverage. And this gives me a chance to say that I was very glad that Professor Liu mentioned the May 4th movement, because I think that, this is just my opinion, my perception is that Chinese leaders are afraid of what they call chaos, Luan. And that the what happened in the 1920s and 30s is very much on their minds and associated somehow with sort of unleashing human rights and a civil society, suddenly. The next one is the final one is the question of Taiwan's arms sales to Taiwan. What is the priority of the Obama administration? Why do I disagree with the statement that Taiwan is used as a card to curb China? All the commentaries I ever hear from the Chinese about Taiwan never say one word about China's own military buildup on its side of the straits. I mean, the number of missiles that keep being added facing Taiwan, the growing military capability. I mean, there's a mirror imaging problem here. You know, it's a little bit like an arms race of any other kind. You know, each side perceives that the other one is getting stronger, so there's an upward ratcheting quality. And I think that's really dangerous. But it's important for Chinese to realize that there are limits on these arms sales, that they have been, in fact, discussed with China well before they were announced publicly. Certain advanced capabilities that the Taiwan government wanted were not delivered. I mean, it's a lot more shades of gray than I hear when the Chinese complain about this. I think the priority of the Obama administration is exactly the same as just about every other administration. With these few lapses or improper statements, it's to make sure that there is peaceful development across the strait, peaceful change, and that no change occurs that doesn't have the consent of the peoples involved. So I think, frankly, if Chen Shui-bian had been and made those remarks and taken those steps, and Obama had been president, I think the same thing would have happened. I mean, I think that now we have Ma Ying-jeou, so there's no occasion for the Obama administration to make public statements with Wen Jiabao. But I think the same thing would have happened. I really do see more consistency in Taiwan policy than the Chinese do. Here I would add too that it is the Chinese who have been cutting relations in the military-to-military domain. I mean, I think that the visits and exchanges and joint rescue at sea operations and so forth between the U.S. and China is a very constructive development. But whenever there's the I shouldn't say whenever, but in response to the latest arms sale to Taiwan, the Chinese cut off military-to-military relations. I've heard the commander of the 7th Fleet and the commander of the Pacific Command say that they want more military cooperation with China, and complaining about certain kinds of classification restrictions on our end that prevent even closer relations. But it's the Chinese who cut these things off. As for Taiwan being used as a card to curb China, I think this is... I think this overlooks the, among other things, the regional and global context that I mentioned. It's true, I think, that the Southeast Asians and others in Northeast Asia understand and perhaps even agree that Taiwan is a domestic issue for China. Maybe. They may not care one way or the other, but I think that they do see... if China were hypothetically to invade and occupy Taiwan, I think this would be a very negative signal in the region, so that our policy towards Taiwan is partly Taiwan-specific but partly consistent with the rest of our policies in the region. The Chinese made an effort at certain times to get Southeast Asians to give up their alliances with the United States because alliances were a Cold War relic. But as the Singapore defense minister said when I was at the Shangri-La dialogue, we view alliances pragmatically. Do they help or not to promote stability and so forth? And he said, we think they help, you know. I think there's this sort of disproportionate paranoia, and I use the word advisedly, that there's this dark force that wants to curb China, and we just use Taiwan very cynically towards that end. I think that in my exposure to political military people, the number of people who want to curb China or send them backwards is minuscule. What they do want is to ensure that China's military power is exercised in a way that's consistent with U.S. Concern for stability in the region and what we see as China's interest in stability in the region. So I understand that the perception exists, but I really can say with some experience that I think it's inaccurate. Sorry to take so long.
Thank you very much. Professor Tao, please.
Well, first of all, I agree with Ellen when she said that during Chen Shui-bian years, the U.S. president were President Obama, then the U.S. policy probably would be the same. I agree with that. And I said in China many times that U.S. policy does not support Taiwan independence. It's a real policy. And we have proved here during Bush years. Yeah, so, well, I've got a few questions. First, Dr. Xiang's question. Yes, you are right. Yeah, in 1981, we have a dispute over possible U.S. F-16 sale to Taiwan, and in 1982, we signed the third communique. But after signing of that communique, Taiwan was put onto the back burner. So during the whole 1980s, Taiwan issue was not outstanding. And especially after Zhao Ziyang's visit to U.S., I was a visiting scholar at the time, and Ronald Reagan's visit to China, I think our bilateral relations were quite smooth. Yeah. So I still think that decade is a golden age. Secondly, Bob's question about McChrystal. Not many Chinese pay attention to McChrystal's recall, but we understand, you know, there's some kind of a precedent. For instance, during the World War II, President Roosevelt recalled General Stilwell from China. That also is in my realm of study. And in 1951, President Truman fired MacArthur. Yeah. So it shows that U.S. principle of a civilian control of the military. Military has to obey to the civilian. That is one of the principles of U.S. democracy. But also it shows the discipline President Obama wants to impose. Yeah. It also shows that this is a very, very complicated problem, Afghanistan. You know, Republicans, Democrats, different people have different views about that. Some people think that if U.S. continue to fight Afghanistan, then it will be graveyard for the U.S. This is a graveyard for empire. Some people say we have to continue to do so. Otherwise, the outcome will be more serious than our failure in Vietnam. So it's a very complicated problem. So the question, how do I see Obama's policy and et cetera? Well, first of all, I think President Obama it's a very controversial question. As the U.S. society has become more and more polarized, it seems to me, you know, at present, all the Democrats' request or legislature met with resistance from the Republicans in the Congress. Yeah. So I think all President Obama does, people here have different opinions, you know. And with regard to Copenhagen, yeah, we heard a lot of different opinions, but actually, I talked to some American specialists, including Ken Lieberthal from Brookings. He very clearly told me, during the first 13 days, delegates were criticizing each other. If Premier Wen Jiabao did not come to Copenhagen, then the meeting would be a total failure. After Premier Wen Jiabao came to the Copenhagen, and because of cooperation between China, India, South Africa, and the United States, Copenhagen at last reached a kind of agreement. So this actually is a success of cooperation between China and the United States. So people may have very different opinions about that. Yeah. Well, how China's public is so sophisticated, I would not say Chinese public is so sophisticated. And yesterday we mentioned, you know, public in Shanghai and public in Guangzhou, public in Beijing may have different concerns. But I think our media, including CCTV, is educating our public. And Dr. Sun, Professor Zhou, and myself, we are all participating in this kind of education. We want our public to take more sophisticated view of the developments around the world and have a more balanced view of that. And I think our work is to a certain degree successful. Well, another question is Professor Cohen's human rights question. You know, even before China's PNTR, although the U.S. Congress had the right to review China's MFN each year, but the U.S. policy did not prove success. You know, although the U.S., even Clinton administration, and also the or the George W. Bush Senior administration 11 times put China's case in the United Nations Human Rights Commission, but each time it was a failure. So the policy did not work. And I think to continue that policy is really meaningless. And now we still have a channel to talk about this human rights. In the last session, Professor Liu Jianfei also elaborated that question. We do have a problem here with human rights, as an example he made, Sun Zhigang, in Sun Zhigang's case, and many cases, actually. You can list many cases of human rights abuses in China, and it may happen maybe each day, because China is so big. We have 1.3 trillion people. Yeah. So we are making progress, but it takes time. And with the victim mentality, I think the victim mentality is vanishing. Good. Yes. In 1980s, we do have a lot of mentality. We always remember China being invaded, being exploited by foreign powers, etc. And also, you know, in 1994, when Secretary Christo visited China, especially his meeting with Premier Li Peng, Li Peng gave him a lecture of modern Chinese history, how China was being invaded, exploited by foreign powers. That was really a victim mentality. But now I think it's vanishing. Yeah, I'll stop here. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much, Professor Tao. Let's do the concluding remarks. I have a couple points to make. I think I really enjoyed all the talks. I think related to the mutual perceptions, each of our countries see the other party as a beauty and a beast. And so, you know, the United States was called a beautiful imperialist country. And yesterday we saw the big picture China saw, you know, China becoming a super draw, trying to have some kind of economic invasion or whatever. So the problem is how can we deal with this kind of a misperception and work out a mutual good relationship? So I have a 5 point to offer and observation to offer. So maybe I just say the first 3 points. The first point, I think we should pay more attention. Of course, I'm saying about all these things from Chinese point of view. First point, the structural change of international system and its impact on the change of Chinese foreign policy, pattern of behavior of Chinese foreign policy. I think the rise of China, people have various evidence. You know, when I participate a lot of workshops in China, people always said that back to 10 years ago, the GDP, share of the GDP of the United States is something like 32% of the world GDP, but now last year it's only 23%. 10 years ago, the GDP, total volume GDP of China is about less than $2 trillion, but last year, $5 trillion. So it's really show some kind of China is relatively improved its economic power. And so that change gave China some more self-confidence. I think that gave China work out new framework for its foreign policy. It's at four basic elements. The first is China emphasized, put more priority paying special attention to its neighboring country. You know, China, its priority of Chinese foreign policy is to work out good relationship with Korea, with, you know, Southeast Asian plus three or whatever, this kind of framework. The second elements of the framework of Chinese foreign policy is what we call the key relationship with the superpowers, with the United States, with Russia, with Japan, with those important countries. The third elements of framework, Chinese foreign policy framework, is emphasize of developing countries as a foundation of Chinese foreign policy. And the last one is China is trying to use multilateral diplomacy as an arena You know, so that's why you see the Chinese leaders appear on G20 BRICS summit. So this is a change of new establishment of new framework of Chinese foreign policy, and also the principle has changed. What I summarize is that China work out four pieces doctrine in the last 10 years to emphasize as a guideline for its foreign policy practice. The first piece is to emphasize a peaceful or harmonious society at home, you know, trying to deal with its social problem, because it's a driving force of the Chinese foreign policy is domestic peace. And the second piece, what I call, is a peaceful development. The third piece is a harmonious world. China is trying to send a positive message, you know, against the background of Iraq war. You know, everything you have to talk first. You have some kind of a peaceful solution first, rather than using force. The last one, what I call the fourth piece, is a peace agreement with Taiwan. You know, that's four peace doctrine. You know, over the last 10 years. That's the first point I want to make. The second point I want to make, the general development of U.S.-China relations. I think as Professor Tao mentioned, on December 15th, 1978, Deng Xiaoping with two countries announced that we decided to establish bilateral relationship, and that is some kind of a related to China's open door policy. But 3 days after, in December 18th, the third plenary session of Chinese Communist Party convened. That's related to domestic reform. So reform and open door policy are intertwined. So this is the two great men, President Carter, Deng Xiaoping's vision at that time, you know, help us to establish, open up a window of opportunity. But after 30 years, you see people-to-people contact. You see a new framework of 64 channel of dialogue has been established. People-to-people contact expanding every day. So that is we just cannot forget the picture. But still, the two countries are politically suspicious about each other, and economically hopeful, and practically we are uncertain in a lot of areas, and dialogue on human rights or whatever. Especially when China is not certain about its what kind of a as goals in the future, you know, what kind of country you want to become. You know, want to become a socialist country, you want to become a regional power, responsible stakeholder in the international arena. We don't have a clear goals. But so far, China's performance is so good. You know, it's okay. And even the United States sometimes think China might be a potential threat, but the United States is also confident that you can handle it. You can handle the potential threat. So there is some kind of a mutual hedging strategies going on. I think both each of us, the United States want to shape China's strategic choice, you know, like what you mentioned, the military use of force. And China also want to use this kind of strategic opportunity of 20 years, you know, strategic opportunity to build up its economic power. So that is something what we have done over the past 10 years. So lessons learned in the past 10, 20 years, I think at least we learned some lessons. Number one, policy of containment. Containments failed, don't work. So both countries, we need noble, admirable, likable policy towards each other, you know, practical policy towards each other. And also, we have to have some kind of secret dialogue, a channel of communication in terms whenever we have a crisis, you know, EP3 incident. We have a Yellow Seas skirmish. We have to have some kind of dialogue. And that's the first lesson we learned. Second lesson we learned, we need some kind of patience, you know. So, and I remember one general in China told me that if you slap a boy, when he was 5 years old. Maybe he said nothing. But if you slap a boy when he was 15 years old, and he'll stare at you, he hate you. But China is 30 years old, you know. So he may fight back. So that general Chinese general comments talking about the military confrontation. But I think as I mentioned, that China is searching its soul. I think China need to take more actions to earn international respect. You know, respect not coming automatically. We have to earn it. We have to shoulder more international responsibilities. That second lesson, the patience. Third lesson we learned is communication skills. I think in the next 10 years we need, very hard to imagine we have a total war against each other. So the problem is the crisis management. We need communication skills. We need both parties need to learn how to deal with the crisis. So that is lessons we learned. And that's my second point, you know, the general developments of U.S.-China relations. Third point I want to make, this is actually, if you quote, don't mention my name, all right? I worry about the recent debate in China, the perceptual change. You know, I don't want to mention what Professor Tao have said, but I would like to mention three particular things. The first trend is I think some of the intellectuals, scholars, experts, they used to think that the United States is a role model we have to follow. We have to, like Deng Xiaoping said, why you decided to establish diplomatic relations with the United States. I said to those countries who follow the United States, all get rich. You know, so that's one thing. In 80s, 90s, a lot of people think the United States is a role model for China. But now, and also when people think that way, people want to take advantage of falling the United States, you know, building up your own strength, whatever. But now, a lot of people begin to think it's useless to, if you pay, mobilize all the national resources to trying to work out good good U.S.-China relations, it's useless because United States continue to sell arms to Taiwan, continue to have some kind of surveillance, you know, activities in South China Sea, you know. So it's very serious change. I think that we worry about that, you know, way of thinking. The second thing is I think the change of the mindset is something like most of the Chinese people will think it's better for China to keep a low profile, follow what Deng Xiaoping says, you know, never take the lead. But now, a lot of people began to argue China have to speak up for its own interest, right? 势力不示弱, you have to show what the truth, not the weakness, you know. So that's something I really worry about that. And even a lot of people began to argue that we should work out the Wei-Wei-Jiu-Zhao strategy. You know, you when you deal with the United States, now by one by one, one-to-one fight. It's not if this is a fight of the century, you have to work with Iran, you have to work with North Korea to have some kind of a strategy encircle the United States. So that's very interesting. This is a real debate in China, right? The last trend, I think, is something like people used to say, we need 敢斗愿和, we dare to fight with the United States, but we have to compromise. You know, 敢斗愿和, this is a guiding principle of Chinese foreign policy. But now, some people began to have a doubt, seriously doubt, the 斗而不破, what is po? You know, 斗而不破 means sometimes you have to break the relationship. You have to be taking the confrontational approach to deal with the United States. You know, so if this is an inevitable fight, if this is we cannot avoid a crisis in South China Sea, Yellow Sea, whatever, so China need to prepare the the worst scenario. You know, so even you want to avoid the crisis, but you have to prepare the worst. I think the same true in the United States. People want to don't want the crisis, but you have to prepare. So that is something I think what I worry about, the three trend of internal debate. But basically, the official policy hasn't changed yet. Official policy still emphasizes we're trying to avoid uncertainty, ups and downs. You know, we try to not let single issue, for example, arms sale to Taiwan or the RMB issues, to hijack the bilateral relationship. We still want a stabilized relationship. And also, I think the official policy still emphasizes we need new policy planning for the next 10 years, you know, because if as China is moving forward, we have to work out new strategies to work with the United States to better cooperate with the United States, you know, something like that. And also, official policy still emphasizes we have to make it clear, you know, what is China's core interest. You know, the definition of the China's core interest expanded from, you know, to South China Sea. And the President Obama, when he met President Hu Jintao in April, he says the revaluation of RMB is a core interest, national interest of the United States. You know, so he need to China to pay some attention to it. So China is trying, if China is trying to draw a right line, then we have to reconsider what we can do on this South China Sea, the spying surveillance activities, arms sales related to all some other issues related to China's sovereignty, like Tibet, Xinjiang, and also the official policy, I think, hasn't changed because we really want to work out new area, new highlights for bilateral relationship. For example, in an area of climate change, or energy, can we work together? Can we buy some new technology from the United States? You know, and can we do whatever we said in joint statement. In Washington and Beijing, we set up a joint research center. You know, we co-invest in an energy lab or something like that. We begin with small step, but maybe expand that into a new area of cooperation. And so the problem is how do you enforce what we said in strategic economic dialogue, you know, of five dimensions. I actually like the joint statement because when President Obama visited China, signed with the Chinese government, I think it's more like a business contract rather than communique, you know, so it's a layout. It's almost like a roadmap. If we follow, we'll see the result. So I'm still positive about the future of the relationship because my I think even we have a lot of problem. We have misperceptions, but we do have, you can see China, we have 600 million people under 30 year old. You know, as Professor Chuan Jie said, it make no difference. He work, study at Yale, and he's working at Tsinghua. You know, he can see whatever he want to see. So there's an information chain. Those people who are under 30 year old, they are more like share a lot of similarities with American youth. We have 400 million internet users. We have almost 100 million bloggers. So you see the generational change. So even if we cannot work out what I call synchronized swim, so beautifully down to all, you know, same move, but we can, if we follow the principle or philosophy of peaceful competition, then we'll work out a decent, some kind of Olympic Games. That's my thought on this. Thank you. Ambassador Roy, that's your turn.
Professor Sun Jia, I'd like to begin by expressing real thanks to you and your colleagues from China for traveling so far to contribute to what I think has been a very lively and stimulating discussion of mutual public perceptions. What we heard, I thought, very eloquently from our last two speakers was that mutual public perceptions are not a theoretical issue. They actually affect how governments and people relate to each other. I thought it was a good example that you could argue that it was the perception of China in 1993 by the United States, but it was also more broadly shared by the international community that prevented China from hosting the Olympics in 1998. I think probably that was a fortunate outcome because I don't see how in 1998 you could have done as good a job as you did in 2000. You certainly did a very fine job of hosting it in 2008. I think the discussions have helped to look at the question of what are the sources of these mutual public perceptions. The goal of the Kissinger Institute, and we're part of the Wilson Center, which means we're scholarly and nonpartisan in the way we look at these issues, but our goal is to try to improve understanding of issues in U.S.-China relations. And clearly, one of the issues is this question of mutual public perceptions. I thought you put it very well in describing how China's perception of the United States has been changing, and I think Professor Tao did the same thing also. We looked at it in terms of how students and scholars influence this, how the media influence it. If all the media, I think, was presented such an eloquent portrayal as Ms. Tien did, maybe we'd all be better off. We looked at popular culture, how it influences, but we also looked at the different relationships between rulers and issues such as law and religion in the two countries. We've come from very different backgrounds in these areas, and that influences how we relate to each other in these areas. And I thought it was a very stimulating discussion of the differing concepts of individual rights versus collective interests. That also is a factor. What I gained from this is that even what particularly struck me on the discussions of religion and law and individual rights versus group interests is we begin from very different backgrounds historically, but there's been convergence so that the differences now are much less. Professor Liu, I think, pointed out quite accurately that the concept of individual rights has emerged quite strongly in China, while you still have, if, as you put it, a priority given to the concept of group interests. We come at it from a different standpoint. But the United States is always wrestling with the question of how you trade off between individual interests and group interests. We find different ways of addressing these questions, but the differences are less now than they have been in the past. And I think the possibilities for understanding each other has improved, partly because we've been much more exposed to each other over the period since we established diplomatic relations. And this has had much greater influence mutually than lecturing each other. It's the exposure to each other, it seems to me, that has been far more important in terms of enhancing the goals that our governments have shared in trying to find a way to manage the relations under constantly changing circumstances. And certainly China's rapid economic development means that we cannot assume that dealing with China today can be used the same approach in dealing with China 10 years from now. And we need to factor these in to our approach. So I really want to thank you, and I want to thank everybody here for asking so many stimulating questions on a subject that I think is very important in terms of our bilateral relationship. And I'm left with a feeling of optimism rather than pessimism after listening to the discussion. Thank you all for being here.
By the way, Ambassador, we have a gift for you, the symbol of friendship.